Brown.
As traffic rolled up to the bridge toll booth today, workers were tearing down tents and putting away the last remnants of BRIDGEFEST 97. All told, organizers estimate 135,000 people visited the site over the weekend. The Walk of a Lifetime on Friday pulled in the biggest crowds, but many of those with tickets couldn't get to the bridge in time because traffic was backed up for hours.
It's hard to know how much infrastructure to plan, especially for that one particular event. We had parking capacity on this side, on PEI, for about 10,000 cars. That's 25,000 people typically, 6,000 cars in New Brunswick, and we hit numbers we never dreamed of.
And today, people lined up once again, this time at the Confederation Center box office. They came with tickets they didn't use, looking for their money back.
Okay, thank you.
I didn't even bother going because I heard it on the radio that it was all the way down to Bonshaw, so I didn't bother going at all.
I left town at 11 o'clock and I was in there for about 3 hours and I heard on the radio that you weren't allowed to go on the bridge.
Burned, humiliated. It was chaos.
Elsbeth McEachern left Charlottetown at 8:30 in the morning. She was stuck on the New Brunswick side with thousands of others when they were told no one was allowed to start out after 3:30.
I'm not waiting in line for a refund, and nobody's going to refund our ferry money, the time that we took off work to do it. It was a fiasco, and I believe that it was all poor planning.
And I talked to a few of them that were denied access, and it was really tough because some of them just wanted to go up there, and but you have to stick by the plan. You have to stick by the schedule. It's difficult to deviate from it. And we certainly apologize to those that were inconvenienced.
Most of the people who got to BRIDGEFEST had a great time. Others made their own inaugural drive across the bridge.
It was great, real good. Nice and smooth, nice pavement, and great view from up there. Watch the boats going and everything. It's great.
Maggie Brown, CBC News.
More on BRIDGEFEST and the bridge in just a moment, but first a look at the other big story happening tonight, the election.
After 36 days of shaking hands and making speeches, the politicians are waiting tonight for the verdict. We begin with John Jeffrey and a look at Election Day on Prince Edward Island.
At this rural polling station in Alexandra, in the riding of Cardigan, returning officers and the party's official agents had lots of time in their hands as they waited for voters. At this church in Stratford, where there were five polling stations, turnout was described as moderate. In the last federal election, 73% of Islanders cast ballots, sending four Liberal MPs to Ottawa with large majorities. This campaign hasn't inspired the same enthusiasm, and most people predict a much lower voter turnout. The Hillsborough riding will be the most interesting one to watch. The campaign there has been called one of the dirtiest in Island history. Both Liberal George Proud and Conservative Mitch Tweel have had their share of troubles. It was leaked to the press that Proud had to seek court protection in April from creditors because of a failed real estate deal in Ottawa. Also, that he had failed to repay a $6,000 loan to a bootlegger. Then Tweel was forced to call a press conference to confront what he called vicious allegations spread by posters in the last few weeks of the campaign. That leaves NDP candidate Dodie Crane in a strong position. And certainly, her party believes she stands the best chance of winning Hillsborough. Malpeque is another riding to watch because of Wayne Easter, who's fighting for re-election. Easter has been outspoken on issues in the past, but many say that he's towed the Liberal Party line too much, especially on employment insurance reform. PEI has one cabinet minister. That's Lawrence McCauley in Cardigan, who's responsible for ACOA and Veterans Affairs. He'll be judged on just how well he represented PEI's interest in the federal cabinet. The election in Egmont has been called very much a sleeper, and again, Liberal Joe McGuire's fortune will depend upon the federal record on employment insurance reform and job creation. The election results in Prince Edward Island's four ridings may well be determined by who stays home, and just what level of dissatisfaction there is out there with the Liberals on EI reform and jobs. John Jeffrey, CBC News, Charlottetown. Hello.
First thing this morning, Liberal leader Jean Chrétien voted. This is the 11th time his name has appeared on a ballot. But of course, this is the first time he's tried to be re-elected prime minister. And today, he was still defending his election call.
We were at the end of our mandate. We were ahead of our program. We wanted to have a debate on the orientation of for the 21st century. We had that, and we will have the summer to prepare the work for the fall.
You don't get tired of this, Mrs. Chrétien?
Not yet.
Not far away, Chrétien's chief rival for support in Quebec was going to the polls. Gilles Duceppe didn't vote in the riding where he's running, though. He cast his ballot in a neighboring riding where he lives. The Bloc Québécois is hoping for another strong showing in that province.
There are very important numbers of Bloc MPs elected tonight.
How many?
That you'll know tonight as well as me.
But another leader from Quebec is hoping his party makes a comeback. The Conservatives won only 2 seats in the last election. Just before he voted at a church in Sherbrooke, Jean Charest said he expects the PCs will do much better this time.
I've made a few prayers here before in the past, and a few of them have been answered.
The NDP's Alexis McDonough started the day on the racquetball court. She's hoping to end the day with her first seat in Parliament as leader of a party with official status.
I didn't win my racquetball game this morning because I like to save my victories for later in the day. Don't like to peak too soon.
Something else to watch this year, voter turnout. Elections Canada has changed the rules and staggered the hours at polling stations. It's supposed to ensure that this time, no one will have predicted the final results hours before the polls close in the West. That also means polling stations on the prairies and in BC will close much earlier than usual. One of those voting later in Calgary will be Preston Manning of the Reform Party. Brenda Murray, CBC News, Ottawa.
And on that note, polls here on Prince Edward Island will close at 8:30 tonight. CBC national coverage of the election begins at 8 o'clock on both radio and television, and we'll stay with it until the final results are in.
The election campaign touched the opening of the bridge on the weekend. Prime Minister Jean Chrétien was supposed to be there to cut the ribbon, but campaign commitments forced him to cancel, leaving Government Services Minister Deanne Marlowe to do the honors in his place. More on the opening celebrations from Compass's Tom Murphy.
The opening of the Confederation Bridge was marked with pomp and pageantry. A convoy of dignitaries was escorted from New Brunswick to an official ribbon-cutting ceremony on the PEI side.
Ladies and gentlemen, I now declare the Confederation Bridge open.
The man who led the mega project, Paul Gianella, admitted he was nervous about the opening.
Earlier on today, as we were leaving New Brunswick heading this way, it was the first time in 10 years and 1 week that I felt nervous. And I was trying to figure out, sitting in that car, what I was feeling nervous about. And I didn't come up with the answer. Maybe it's because I'm unemployed.
Gianella's mother was on hand, beaming with pride over her son's accomplishment.
You couldn't talk to him. I mean, he was so involved with the project, he didn't have time for anybody, either the family or anybody. You know, I mean, it was very, very tough on him, and he was under lots and lots of strain. So I'm glad that the thing is over, and I hope he doesn't have to go through the stress again.
A stage show paid tribute to the 6,000 people who had a hand in building the bridge, reminding the public of the effort that went into the largest construction project in this part of the world.
I think it's very exciting. It's something, as Islanders, I don't think we thought that this would happen, but it has happened. We're very excited about it.
Shortly after a thrilling display by the snowbirds, hundreds of people lined up for another thrill, their first drive across the Confederation Bridge.
It's a celebration of transportation, the bridge, and we felt, being having the oldest car in PEI, that it should be appropriate that it should go across the bridge.
Five to change, guys. Have a nice afternoon. There's a little bit of memorabilia for you.
Thank you very much.
When the bridge was opened to the public, this truck was the first to cross. Before long, it was bumper-to-bumper traffic on the bridge. Once on the New Brunswick side, just about everyone wanted to lay claim to some title.
Claim the fame today. We were the first
first car, first New Brunswick car, first car over.
Today I try to be the first American over the bridge. I heard I was beat. I'm not sure. I'm from Burlington, Vermont, and I haven't seen any other Vermont license plates, so I'm pretty sure I'm the first Vermonter over.
It was a sensational feeling. It really was. It was definitely one to take home, and the memory will be last forever. And the pictures we took were phenomenal.
And the first trip took longer than the ferry.
And so PEI was ushered into a new era of transportation. Now, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, people will be able to drive across this bridge, PEI's permanent connection to the rest of Canada. Tom Murphy, CBC News, on the Confederation Bridge.
The opening of the bridge was touched by tragedy. 68-year-old Fred Partridge of Sackville, New Brunswick, drowned when his boat tipped over near the bridge. Four other people in the boat were rescued.
The coming of the bridge brought, of course, the end of the ferries. The last scheduled crossing went at 6:30 Saturday evening with the Abaguit, and Ian Petrie was on board.
The bridge was already open to the public, so these are people who want to be here, people who want to take the ferry one last time.
You drove on, you had your, you know, you got out on deck and you looked around, and it was exciting, you know, it was just, you know, part of the, you know, that's what I drove up here for, you know, to go on the ferry.
100-year-old Minnie Allen was there, too. She saw the first ferries come in 80 years ago.
And they took us all through the boat from top to bottom and showed us the whole ocean of it.
We all know the routine, the big rush to the compound, hoping there's room to get on. A sense of relief once the car is parked.
Heavy with the gatekeepers, do you read? You get the fortunate opportunity to let this vessel go for the last time at Terminac, so you can back out the lines and you can take away our apron.
There was always an air of uncertainty taking the ferry. Some saw that as inconvenience, others as adventure.
My family.
But today there were other stronger feelings. These are the last scheduled crossings for these ferries. The skills of boat building and seamanship replaced by sleek design, gutsy engineering, and tons of concrete, a fixed link to the mainland.
I feel like it was sort of a funeral or a wake. I feel very sad, and all the employees, crew, they all feel fairly sad. It's 80 years of service, PEI service coming to an end.
There was lots of ceremony on this last trip, including a mid-strait greeting between the three remaining ferries.
Starboard 10.
Starboard 10.
Captain Roy Coffin, calling on all the skill and dignity he's developed over the last 36 years. He's watched the new Abbey being built, sailed it for the first and now the last time on the Borden Cape Tormentine run.
I feel very, very sad because, for one thing, the ferries are leaving. It's not like I'm retiring personally. If I was, that'd be no big deal. But because the ferries are leaving and the crew that I work with, I'll not be seeing them on a regular basis anymore. That saddens me.
The island and the vacation land will take up new duties on the Wood Island ferry run. The Abbey is up for sale.
You have to handle the employees this weekend. We handled 24,000 passengers yesterday. Just incredible.
I know that BRIDGEFEST needed to be celebrated, but it's so unfortunate that it had to be on our backs. And people were cranky and upset because they were waiting for this walk, and they took it out on us. And you know, if they only knew how hard our hearts were aching and how I wanted to grasp every second and moment of my last moment with this outfit, and I couldn't.
When is it all going to hit everybody, do you think?
About 3 weeks. Or maybe a month. Everybody wants it all summer off anyway.
And they're going to get it, I guess.
Then they're going to get it. There's not going to be anything back, though.
What would you like islanders to remember about the ferry service?
Oh,
just that we all done our best.
You're welcome.
To serve them, sometimes under hard circumstances, but we done our best.
How about yourself? Have you got some new job lined up?
Or? Not yet. I've been looking, and but there's no jobs out there right now. It's just every time we go for an interview, I like to say, we'll call you.
What would you like Islanders to remember about the ferry service?
Well, I would say probably the people that worked here and the good memories that comes with the place, and a lot of years of friendships and things that'll probably be gone now.
Our company always had family things, and you know, you just, it's not very often you get to have a company that you get to be with your family and friends and, you know, have a good time.
Some girl said it's like celebrating a wedding, but then also having a wake right beside it.
I remember the sunsets, the sunrises, and it's just working with Mother Nature. She was beautiful. She could be rough. I mean, I will never, ever, you know, I will never have this opportunity again, I don't believe, in my lifetime. And I believe that we're getting faster transportation, but we're losing communication. We're losing people contact, and that's so sad.
On the church.
On the church.
Thank you.
Ian Petrie, CBC News, Borden.
There are some who feel the bridge is going to cost Prince Edward Island more than just its ferry service. They worry that what we've come to know as the island way of life has been lost. Yesterday in Charlottetown, some of them held a vigil to mourn its passing.
After everything was done with the bridge, I felt a great sense of helplessness at it being built, and the whole issue, environmental issue, and the people that were opposed to the link, we sort of just got brushed over by things. And I felt very helpless, and I felt helpless this weekend as all the festivities were going on. So I'm just going to sing this song.
Big white beaches and forever skies, a unique way of art and life, leave us helpless, helpless, helpless.
Despite the fact that people protested over the last number of years and have documented similar situations with similar devastating effects on communities, we still have this particular development in the province, and we are now facing another major hurdle in ensuring that this project does bring prosperity to the people of Prince Edward Island.
There's no sense crying about what happened. I'm disappointed with the bridge. It's going to make tremendous changes on Prince Edward Island, like people never dreamt. I hope that people can adjust to it.
During our minute of silence, we keep in mind the three who died building the bridge, our precious environment, and especially the 600 workers who find themselves unemployed this morning.
Who can sleep when their ferry's bleat no longer weeps and comforts them like a mother? Who must mourn, sad and forlorn, those of Borden bred, those of Borden born?
This is my island, Prince Edward Island, good for love and every growing thing.
A couple of other stories we should touch on tonight. A man from Cornwall died yesterday in a car accident in New Brunswick. 21-year-old Bruce St. Ange was killed when his car slammed into a transport truck on the highway near Fredericton. Both vehicles exploded, but the driver of the truck got away with only minor injuries.
Disbarred Charlottetown lawyer Dean Shaw has filed an appeal. On Friday, he was sentenced to 4 years in jail in order to pay back $210,000 that he took from clients' accounts. And today, he filed papers asking for a new trial, or failing that, a reduced sentence.
Well, still to come in national and international news, a verdict late today in the case of Oklahoma bomber Timothy McVeigh. We'll tell you what that is in just a moment.
Standing by at Confederation Bridge this Monday evening, Election Day here in Canada, is Kevin Gallant. Kevin, it was windy there on Friday when we last visited the site. What's it like tonight?
Well, it's actually a little more windier than it was Friday. I don't know if this was all part of opening the bridge. We're going to get more wind to the island, but it continues. And actually, I think the wind has actually picked up here in the last hour, but the winds are supposed to diminish out of the north at 20 overnight tonight. As you can see behind me, the traffic flowing freely over the Confederation Bridge, and the air continues to blow freely from the north. We are looking for lots of sunshine, but continuing cool temperatures throughout much of this week. Good news for potato farmers, though, with this good weather. I'll be back a little later in Compass from Borden Carleton at the site of the Confederation Bridge with all those weather details.
The verdict is in on the Oklahoma City bombing trial, and it's guilty on all counts. Timothy McVeigh has been convicted of blowing up a U.S. federal building in April 1995. And in the process, killing 168 people. Keith Vogue reports.
It was clear from some spectators leaving the courtroom they felt justice had been done. Among them were family and friends of some of those who died in the bombing in Oklahoma City.
We got him!
There was that, and there were tears.
Conspiracy? Guilty. Guilty.
And back in Oklahoma City, more watched coverage of the verdict on television.
When we all got up, it was clapping, hugging, still crying, but...
There was cheering for the prosecutors who had evidently presented a strong case in a thorough and convincing manner.
We always had confidence in our evidence. Now everyone else will have confidence in the evidence in the verdict. We're ready to move on to the next stage.
Timothy McVeigh was found guilty on all charges. Guilty on 11 counts of murder. Guilty of conspiracy to use a weapon of mass destruction to blow up the federal building in Oklahoma City, an explosion that killed 168 people. There was evidence McVeigh rented the truck that contained the bomb. There was evidence that fibers on his clothing came from materials used to make the bomb. And perhaps most damaging was the testimony of Michael Fortier, a friend of McVeigh. Fortier testified that he discussed with McVeigh both his plan to build the bomb and his decision to target the federal building in Oklahoma City. McVeigh may not have acted alone in blowing up the federal building in 1995. Still to come is the trial of Terry Nichols, who is also charged in the crime. Still to come also is the penalty phase of McVeigh's trial. The prosecutors will argue for the death penalty when that phase begins later this week.
We have visited with Mr. McVeigh. We will be working with him tonight and tomorrow for the preparation of the second stage on Wednesday.
The trial took less than half the time expected. The government presented its case cleanly and efficiently, and the judge kept strict control of his courtroom. It was a high-profile case, but it was in no way a circus. And because of that, there is a feeling among some that the damaged reputation of the American justice system may have been restored a little by this. Keith Bogue, CBC News, Washington.
The Queen Elizabeth Health Sciences Center in Halifax named an independent panel today to review its handling of the case of Dr. Nancy Morrison. She's the specialist charged with first-degree murder in the death of one of her patients. More in this report from Rob Gordon.
Dr. Nancy Morrison's first-degree murder charge is a matter between her and the police. What the hospital wants to know is if the former professor of the year at Dell Med School was treated properly by her peers.
Quite a crowd.
Don Sherman is CEO of the QE2. He says the panel will probe Morrison's suspension surrounding the death of a patient in her care.
What it's intended to do is to try to examine how the case was handled when hospital officials became aware of the incident, how we managed that process, how we determined what action should be taken, if any, and how it was reported or not reported to various official parties.
Police raided the hospital 3 weeks ago after this doctor complained the hospital was covering up the facts surrounding the death of Paul Mills and Morrison's role in it. The external review panel will be chaired by Dr. Charles Wright of British Columbia. Nova Scotians on the panel include Halifax businessman Larry Doan, lawyer Bill Grant, Ken McKinnon, and Brenda Payne. Rob Gordon, CBC News, Halifax.
Overseas, there's a new player on the international stage. He's Lionel Jospin, the new Prime Minister of France. He was named today after his socialists came out on top in the parliamentary elections. And he'll be sharing power with France's conservative president, Jacques Chirac. Paul Workman reports.
In France, they call it cohabitation. And for Lionel Jospin, it began with a trip to the presidential palace. The president of the Republic, I accepted. It means that France now enters a state of unavoidable political hostility. A socialist prime minister sharing power with a Gaullist president whose decision to call early elections turned out to be a colossal
punished, basically, because he misperceived the weight of French despair, of French unhappiness. And he underestimated grossly.
I think the government paid for all of its mistakes, its cynicism, and its arrogance, says this woman. French newspapers made much of Chirac's humiliation, tried to analyze what the results mean. It's a new chance, said one headline.
We'll find some new goals for the future for our country. I think the people need it. Some new dreams for our country.
The socialists made a remarkable comeback. Nevertheless, it's their allies, the communists, who now hold the balance of power. And that only adds to the confusion in Europe. Essentially, the French have said no, refused to make a sacrifice for Europe. How does all of this now threaten the grand plans for a single currency?
The French want change, but change without cost and without risk. They want the euro, but they want jobs above the euro.
President Chirac has paid severely for his misjudgment. His leadership has been weakened, his credibility and his competence called into question. He gave up nearly absolute power to call the elections early and ended up sharing it. Paul Workman, CBC News, Paris.
And still to come, we're going to drop in one of the very last official functions of the MV Abiquit. It was last night, a charity fundraiser for the Grand Old Ship.
And of course, we'll have the windy weather details from the PEI end of the bridge with Kevin Boomer Gallant when we come back. Don't go away.
Air Nova is a very warm, friendly airline. People always seem to be happy to have you with them.
I could reach out to embrace you the way Air Nova does me.
And they interact with you, and they're fun.
Air Nova is a great airline, right?
Air Nova.
Wow.
I'm thirsty.
Yeah, for something different.
Hi, Mom.
Hi, guys.
Got anything interesting?
Absolutely.
Hey, listen up. Cola, orange, hey, some purple stuff, Sunny Delight.
Sunny D. Heard it's awesome.
Cool.
Tastes like orange and tangerine.
Lime.
It's got some vitamins in it. Your mom's all right. Yeah, she's cool.
Sunny Delight is here. It's goodness kids go for.
Awesome.
What's wrong?
Mommy, titties hurt.
Oh, don't cry.
A bathroom tissue soft enough for your child's tender face?
Paper.
It's soft. See? Here, I can fix them.
It's Royale bathroom tissue. So kidney soft, it could be facial tissue.
Look, Teddy's all better.
Thanks, Mom.
Royale bathroom tissue. So soft, it could be facial tissue.
Men never focus on the journey, just the destination.
No way.
Take this treasure hunt game.
Not my game.
For men, the thrill is the treasure.
$10,000 is nice.
For women, it's the quest. Piecing together the clues.
New Scratch and Win Treasure Hunt. A little more scratching, a lot more fun.
Hey, I won!
So what happened to the journey?
Oh.
Play New Treasure Hunt today.
Everywhere I look around, love is in the air. Oh, love is in the air.
Surprise your taste buds with the sizzling sensation of delicious pork. Any way you prepare it, it's a perfect barbecue treat. So why not pick pork? For your free recipes, call 892-4201. Give your summer cookout more sizzle with great tasting pork. It's a delicious way to add variety to your barbecue. So why not pick pork? For your free recipes, call 892-4201.
What do I like about Air Nova? It's bringing us together. We've been going out long distance for our entire relationship. It's made it instead of breaking it. Thank God for Air Nova.
Air Nova!
Tuesday on Island Morning, analysis of Election 97. We'll talk to some of the winners and losers in the four Prince Edward Island ridings. As well, we'll hear from our political panelists. Jack McAndrew, Martin Durrell, and Ken Kingston will review the results and talk about what Islanders can expect from a new government in Ottawa. Island Morning, your radio election headquarters on FM 96.
Tonight's weather is brought to you by Vogue Optical. For quality eyewear and a second pair of free policy every day, see Vogue Optical with five island locations.
And time now for the weather tonight, right up to the minute.
That's right. We have Kevin Boomer Gallant live from Borden Carlton, the site of the bridge.
Well, thank you, Roger and Sarah. Yeah, hi, cars are blowing their horns here. Everybody's excited about the link behind us. It's the Confederation Bridge, as we officially know it now. And the weather up here in Borden Carlton this evening, the winds continue to howl. When we got here about an hour and a half ago, there were no whitecaps, but there are now. Those northerly winds are expected to diminish. And speaking of weather, on the bridge behind me, there's at least four weather monitoring stations that will be looked at 24 hours a day. And on these, there's a temperature gauge, obviously, an anemometer for wind speed, solar panel to record sunshine data, and also a small Doppler radar. And what a Doppler radar does is sense or get precipitation that is falling in various forms throughout the four seasons that we have here on Prince Edward Island. So the weather, a very important monitored effect here on the Confederation Bridge behind me, always being looked at. And I can tell you, looking at the weather, there's not a cloud in sight from Tignish to Kapolei. Let's check weather conditions around Prince Edward Island this afternoon. With those cool northerly winds blowing, we had 9 degrees in Charlottetown and up here Borden Carlton way. Tignish, sunny at 8, East Baltic sunshine at cool 7. In New Brunswick, inland temperatures a little warmer. The Miramichi at 18, Fredericton 20, Moncton at 14, St. John at 19 with lots of blue skies. Nova Scotia, Yarmouth at 12, Greenwood 19, Halifax at 18 with sunshine. Then we hit the locations close to the water with those northerly winds. Pictou in Sydney, sunshine but cool at 8 degrees. Well, the reason for all of this wind and clear skies is a high pressure system, the front side, giving us these northerly winds coming right from the Arctic, I guess you could say, and a low pressure system out to sea between the two, the air causing the winds. But the high pressure system is going to remain put over the next 3 or 4 days. It is keeping a low pressure system down in the Boston area, and they're getting lots of rain over the next 3 or 4 days. So despite the cool temperatures, I don't think we should complain, because we are going to see the sunshine thanks to this cool ridge of high pressure. So with that, let's recap the island forecast. For tonight, we are looking for clear skies and diminishing winds. We're looking for a low of 3 degrees, and that could give a risk of frost, especially in low-lying areas. Winds should diminish to the north at 20 kilometers per hour. Tomorrow, a mix of sun and cloud, a high of 13 degrees, and winds still out of the northwest at 20 kilometers per hour. The long-range outlook for Wednesday, a mix of sun and cloud at 13, Thursday sun and cloud at 14, and Friday right now looks like even cooler temperatures, mix of sun and cloud, chance of a shower at just 11 degrees. So I guess you could say it's only going to be half as cold right now as it's going to be tonight. I did lose a glove on the way up here, I think it may be on the navigation span. But that's it from the Prince Edward Island side of the Confederation Bridge here in Borden Carlton here this evening. Roger and Sarah, back to you.
Thank you very much, Kevin. And of course, we'll check in with Kevin about 5 to 7. And See if the winds subside any this evening.
That's right. He'll still be up in Bordentown-Carlton. He won't make it back in the next 25 minutes. Well, still to come, we will have sights and sounds from the historic weekend from Bordentown-Carlton, including a special crossing of the MV Abiquit. That's when we come back.
Naturally, we're flattered that many consider Honda's Accord the benchmark for engineering and performance in its class. So here's another point for comparison. For a very limited time, lease a new Accord EX with air and automatic for only $298 a month. Where do you suppose that will leave the competition?
Certa, perfect sleeper. Certa, we make the world's best mattress.
Pit Row, we get them in and out in a hurry. Now you bring your car to Goodwrench and that's what you get. Lube, oil, and filter change in 29 minutes or your next one's free. You get a free 15-point inspection, free fluid top-ups, and a price we stick to. Only $23.95. And there's factory-trained technicians who work here. And here's the point. Goodwrench makes good sense. Goodwrench service at your Atlantic GM dealers.
At Matheson Eyewear, what you see is what you get. And that's a top-quality, brand-name frame that makes you look your very best. If looking good is as important to you as it is to us, we'd like to see you.
Matheson Eyewear. One good pair of glasses at one great price.
Color and beauty. Healthy plants for your flower gardens. Available at the Garden Center at Sherwood DeWitt Center. Annuals, trees, and shrubs. Whatever your gardening needs, the staff at the Garden Center will assist you in finding just what you require. Sherwood DeWitt Center has it all. Complement your landscaping all summer long with the natural beauty and color of flowers, trees, and shrubs from the Garden Center at Sherwood DeWitt Center on Mount Edward Road.
More now on the new advance in brake technology announced by Midas. When tested by a major Canadian police force, these new carbon metallic brake pads lasted twice as long as ordinary brake pads. So now the police are spending more time on the road between repairs. In other news, donut shops are reporting their best sales in years.
New performance friction carbon metallic brake pads, now at Midas.
Closed captioning of this program is brought to you by your Atlantic Ford and Mercury dealers, home of the Ford F-Series, Canada's number one selling vehicle.
Earlier this evening, we took you on board the MV Abiquit for its last scheduled crossing of the Northumberland Strait, but it actually made one more trip after that.
It was a special crossing billed as the Sunset Sail, a charity fundraiser where the passengers paid $125 apiece for the chance to make a little history. Matthew Rainey was there.
People filtered onto the Abiquit Ferry at Bordentown-Carlton last night to be part of history, a final voyage to celebrate 80 years of ferry service. Lois Mullins has used the service for half of those years.
That we thought we would want to come on this trip and enjoy it for a last time.
Wow.
This wasn't a typical ferry crossing. It was a five-hour voyage called the Sunset Sail. It's a fundraiser for three Rotary clubs and Marine Atlantic. 650 people paid $125 each to be part of it, and the money will be going to charity.
Nice to be able to go out with some pride, to hold our heads high and be able to do something like this, and hoping that everybody will appreciate what we're doing.
It's really an honor and a privilege to be a part of it, so it's a much lighter feeling than it was yesterday.
For its final trip, the Abbey had a riverboat feel.
Okay, thanks.
Do we have 12,000 anywhere? 12. Do we have 13?
It's expected each group involved in putting this on will receive about $15,000. Marine Atlantic is looking at putting its share into scholarships for the families of employees.
We're riding on the ferries of glory.
I felt for them all weekend. We walked the bridge from New Brunswick to PEI on Friday, and there was a feeling of jubilation. Everybody was so happy. But yet there is that tinge of sadness. There has to be, because it is the end of an era.
The Abbey leaves Borden-Carlton for the last time later this week. It's up for sale and will be docked in Sydney until a buyer is found. Marine Atlantic employees will be on board it one last time for a private party and a final chance to say goodbye.
Last night was quite downcast and quite sad for obvious reasons. It was the last official crossing of the service. Tonight we're here to commemorate the 80 years of service and the people who have worked here for that time. And we're going out with a bang.
Matthew Rainey, CBC News, off Borden-Carlton.
Wow. Look at those fireworks. And the fireworks on Friday night were just amazing as well, with Boko Suzuki's music, mm-hmm. and they're going off in time. Oh, it was great. And we're going to look back some more on some of the sights and sounds of BRIDGEFEST.
That's when we come back, so stay with us for that.
Wondering about the best value for your dollar? You might want to weigh the options. Islandtel employs over 300 men and women on Prince Edward Island, buys local goods and services, supports island charities and community programs. All this, and offers a complete range of services at a truly competitive price, delivered right here on PEI. And what do the other companies offer? Islandtel. Now that's real value.
Bagnall's Home Care cares about your home.
Landscaping your property will increase the value of your home and extend your home enjoyment to the outdoors. At Bagnall's Garden Center, we're here to help you. We have an unmatched selection of flowering shrubs, perennials, trees, and roses to make your home and area colorful and attractive. We've got everything you'll need and lots of free advice, too.
Bagnall's Home Care cares about your home.
You're the type that likes to start early.
Yeah. Look at that cloud there.
That's okay. We're ready when you are. GMC Sierra. 365 days a year.
ACA Co-op is proud to introduce Eden Valley Farms. For over 50 years, we've raised our chickens right here in the Maritimes. When you want chicken that meets your standards, look for Eden Valley Farms. Chicken as you like it. Fresh, well-trimmed, and ready for any recipe. Your satisfaction is guaranteed. Eden Valley Farms. Bring home the good life.
Take the right step to a better insurance program.
Dan, that's exactly what I tell people. I hope whoever that property owner is, they're covered under their home or commercial insurance plans.
Other insurance companies talk about discounts, but they just don't deliver on service.
People depend on us here at Peek & McGinnis because we're an island company. We're here to take care of islanders.
And that's just good service.
And good sense.
Because you never know when you'll need insurance.
From Peek & McGinnis.
Well, it was quite a weekend.
That's for sure. A three-day bash they called BRIDGEFEST 97.
And we have a recap now of some of the sights and sounds.
Oh, this is a rescue vehicle, just in case you can't make it.
And I was at North Tryon at 11.
And it's now?
It's now 20 to 3.
Free water. There you go.
Our feet are going to be on TV.
It's big.
I'm terrified of heights. My toes are curled up inside my sneakers.
Three hours and 50 minutes in line. All we want is a bathroom.
I think it's a little bit of Canada history, Canadian history.
All right, no problem.
There you go, sir.
Somebody's got to get me some hamburgers.
Are you ready for a hot dog?
Ketchup, hockey, above the squad, the list goes on and on. He really doesn't need any introduction, but I'm going to give him one anyway. Here's Stompin' Tom with the song, you guessed it, about the Confederation Bridge.
Well, from 9:30, we spent, I guess, five and a half hours. We got as close as probably 1,000 yards from the gate, and it wasn't going anywhere, so we give up.
Hello, I'm Norma Lee McLeod. Welcome to Gordon, Prince Edward Island.
I'm Brent Bambury.
Let's have a listen to what's happening in New Brunswick as Deanne Marlowe opens the gates.
Done. Voila. Congratulations.
So here's the site as the official party leaves New Brunswick, headed for the navigational span where they will stop and meet up with Prince Edward Island Premier Pat Binns, who's waiting for them.
Here are the wooden decks of Blue Nose 2 as she heads underneath the Confederation Bridge in full sail.
Here are the snowbirds.
Here they are flying in formation along the span of the Confederation Bridge. Deanne Marlowe now with Benjamin and Sabrina Campbell, ages 6 and 9.
God bless this bridge and all who helped to build it.
Oh, Roger, it was just the experience of a lifetime. I wouldn't have missed it for all the world.
How's it going?
What a day.
We built a quality structure that's going to be here for a long, long time. We built it on time. We did exactly what we said we would. We finished it when we said we would. And last but not least, we did all of that with Canadians.
Now the Mi'kmaq dancers and drummers are being heard from. That's who we're seeing now on stage.
Canada and the world are now officially connected to Prince Edward Island.
Yeah, there's going to be lots of changes. Some people like it, and some people are looking up Kevorkian in the phone book. The way I look at it, if God wanted there to be a bridge to PEI, wouldn't he put one there himself, you know? My, oh my. But 'tis grand, I guess, all in all, you know. But why is it called straight crossing? What have they got against the gays? You won't get Katie Lang over here. Well, God bless you. I hope you enjoy your bridge. I wouldn't drop acid before attempting it, but other than that, go nuts. God bless you.
Thank you.
Some people dislike New Bridge because maybe become more crowded and more people will come to islands. And some people like peaceful.
Having problems?
No.
Enjoying the view?
Just looking at the view.
It's here. It's finally here.
Didn't think I'd ever see it, but it's great. It's here.
And the view is fantastic. It really is. But the ferry terminal coming over to this side looks kind of abandoned already. You know, it's kind of sad one way, really.
It's my bread and butter for over 50 years. And it's just watching the boats every day. It's just hard. It's just hard not to be able to see them anymore.
I think there's definitely some feelings of sadness to see an era end, but it's very exciting. I can't believe it. I mean, it's wonderful.
My God, it don't seem real. That's all it's doing. Don't seem real.
Those gorgeous fireworks.
So you were there Friday night to witness all of that.
Oh, yeah, I had to stay.
I wanted to, but I
gorgeous.
Couldn't.
You had to be there on Saturday.
That's my problem. You've got it. Kevin Gallant, we'll join with Kevin in just a few moments after these messages to wrap things up for this Monday.
Hi, I'm Shelley Hamilton, and this is the new tide of adventure.
Nice try, Ted. Just keep working it. You'll land it.
Now you can be a part of Tony's Team Tiger. Just practice hard and start with a complete breakfast, including the great taste of Kellogg's Frosted Flakes cereal.
They're great.
Show 'em you're a tiger. So much you can do.
Nice move.
Way to go.
Do your best, join Tony's team. Bring out the tiger in you.
And you.
Patio stones and steps from Marley Concrete Products take every act of get-together in stride. Low maintenance and always ready to put in a beautiful social appearance, Marley Concrete patio stones and steps are manufactured in all kinds of sizes and shapes to suit your needs. Choose attractive and practical patio stones and steps from Marley Concrete for easy installation, versatility, and affordability.
Insist on Marley Concrete Products at your local building supply or call us at 836-4343.
And the Red Wings battle for hockey's highest honor.
The time of the unexpected, the time of the upset.
The Stanley Cup Championship continues tonight on Molson Hockey Night in Canada on CBC.